Welcome. Today's topic is inverse of a matrix by Gauss-Jordan method. Subject code is MA151. Subject name is Mathematics 1. Before discussing the Gauss-Jordan method, we will understand, review some of the determinant properties and how to find inverse of a matrix by Gauss-Jordan method. We have studied properties of determinants, properties of determinants are helpful in evaluating the determinants of higher order. Determinants having large numbers as elements can also be evaluated easily by applying the determinant properties. And we have studied these properties. The first one is that if we interchange the rows and columns of a determinant, for example, in this 2x2 determinant, if we change the rows into column, I have changed first row into first column, second row into second column. In this case, the value of the determinant remains same. Next property is if I interchange two rows, if I interchange one row with another row, then I should give a negative sign to the value, to the determinant. So the value of the determinant will be negative if I change any two row once, interchange any two row once. Third property, the important property, if two rows or two columns of a determinant are same, then the value of the determinant will be 0. And if we multiply a determinant by a constant k, then the effect of multiplying k with whole determinant will be equal to the multiplication of k with any one of the row or any one of the column of the determinant. So this property of the determinant is different than the matrices. For example, if I have a determinant 2, 3, 1, minus 1, and if I multiply this determinant by 3, then it will be equal to multiplying 3 with any of the row or any of the column. So this determinant, so multiplication of this constant with this determinant will be equal to this determinant. Or I can multiply this constant to any second row also only, or to first column or to second column. Now in case of matrices, we have studied scalar multiplication of matrices. So if I have a 2x2 matrix, if I have a 2x2 matrix with same elements, then the multiplication of 3 with this matrix means all the elements of the matrix will be multiplied with 3. So we will have 6, 9, 3, minus 3. So this is the difference of multiplying a constant, a scalar, with a determinant or with a matrix. Vice versa, if we want to take some constant common, then from determinant we can take it common from any row only. Whereas in matrix, if you want to take a constant common, so we should take it common from all the elements. Next property, which is very important, is that if we multiply any row or any column by, if we multiply any row or any column by a constant and then add it to any row or column, then the resultant determinant will have the same value. So we will study this property in detail. Further, you can remember that the determinant of the product of two matrices is equal to the determinant of A matrix, determinant of B matrix. We will try to understand the procedure, the properties of the determinant by example. So first example I am taking is a 2 by 2 matrix. Now you can observe that to calculate this matrix we will require computational effort. We need to multiply 4 to 7 and 3 7 1 and then subtract it from the multiplication of 4 to 9 3 6 9. So ordinarily to calculate this determinant we need to perform this computation. I will show you that by applying determinant properties we can easily calculate this determinant and we can reduce our computational efforts and we can also save time. So we observe that what type of operations can I apply. So if we observe then second column and first column, then difference in the second column and first column is of 2 only. So what I do is I apply this operation C2. I will replace second column by C2 minus C1, that is the subtraction of second and first column. So I will have this determinant and if I calculate the second column again, so I will have 2 at both places. Now I can, this determinant will be equal to this one as per the properties of the determinant. Now I can evaluate this determinant very easily. Further, I can further reduce computational efforts. So for that I concentrated on the first row. If I subtract first row from the second row, then the number will become much smaller in the determinant. So I apply R1 replaced by R1 minus R2. After applying this operation, you will observe first row will convert in this form 4 to 7 minus 3 6 9 2 minus 2. So as a result I will have 58 0 3 6 9 2. Now we can evaluate this statement very easily because there is 1 0 and we have smaller numbers. If we calculate, so we get 116. So 116 is the final value of this determinant. So in this way we can apply our knowledge of properties of determinants to evaluate determinants easily. Further, I take a 3 by 3 determinant. Now to calculate this 3 by 3 determinant, we observe the effect of multiplying a constant to determinant or vice versa. So if I take, we can observe that we can take two common from any row any column. So if I take two common from first row, so I will have this step. After taking two from second row also I will have this step. And next I have taken two common from all the rows, so I have 8 outside the determinant. Now the entries are much simpler. Further, I can apply more operations to create 0 in any row or any column. So I apply operations from the point of view to create zeros in any one row or in any one column, so that I will be able to evaluate So I apply this operation R1 replaced by R1 minus R3. Because of this operation, we will have 0 at this position. You can observe we have obtained a 0. Next, I will try to create 0. We can create 0 at this position very easily by adding C1 and C3. So if I add first and third column and replace the resulting column by first column, that means I need to apply this operation. C1 replaced by C1 plus C3. So after applying this operation, we will have 0 at 1-1 position also. So in this way, I have obtained 2 zeros in first row of this 3x3 determinant, and now I can easily calculate it by expanding it from the first row. So 2 terms will be 0 and third terms will be easily evaluatable. So in this way we can calculate it and the final answer is 30. Further, next, to discuss the inverse of a matrix, the inverse calculation of the inverse of a matrix requires the calculation of adjoint of a square matrix. So I discuss adjoint of a square matrix. So adjoint of a square matrix, as mentioned here, is simply the transpose of the cofactor matrix of A. By the cofactor matrix of A, we mean we will replace every element of the matrix by its a cofactor. We have studied definition of cofactor and how to calculate cofactor. So suppose we have a square matrix of this form, a 3x3 square matrix, then we will see how to calculate adjoint of this square matrix. So as we discussed, the cofactor of a square matrix is the transpose of the cofactor matrix. Adjoint of a matrix is the transpose of the cofactor matrix of the given matrix A. So we will calculate cofactors corresponding to all the position of the given matrix A. So our A matrix is A1, A2, A3, B1, B2, B3, C1, C2, C3. Now we can understand the calculation of corresponding cofactors. So C11 will be calculated by removing the column, first column and first row. So for A1, the cofactor will be the determinant B2, B3, C2, C3. Further, to calculate cofactor corresponding to A2, that is C12, will be obtained by deleting first row and second column. So the cofactor corresponding to 1-2 position, denoted by C12, cofactor of A2 will be equal to B determinant 2x2 determinant B1, B3, C1, C3. You can see. Now alternating plus minus sign position we have discussed. Cofactor will have negative sign in addition to the minor. So that formula we have discussed because cofactor Cij is equal to minus 1 to the power I plus j and corresponding minor. So minor is simply obtained by removing corresponding row and column. To obtain cofactor, we multiply minus 1 to the power I plus j in addition. So here in C11, this minus 1 to the power I plus j becomes 1 because it is minus 1 to the power 2 in this case. Whereas in the case of the calculation of C12, minus 1 to the power I plus j factor becomes minus 1, because 1 plus 2 is 3, minus 1 to the power 3 is equal to minus 1. So that is why we have an additional minus sign here. So the calculation of minor is to replace, to eliminate, to delete, to remove the corresponding rows and columns of that element, and the calculation of cofactor requires additional sign, which can be obtained by this idea, minus 1 to the power I plus j. So if we calculate all the cofactors, then to find adjoint of the matrix A, we need to calculate transpose of the cofactor matrix. So you can see here T symbol representing transpose of this matrix. So when I calculate transpose of this cofactor matrix, that will be the adjoint of A. Adjoint of A will be helpful in the calculation of inverse of any square matrix. Now, I define inverse of a square matrix. So, inverse of a square matrix is defined in this way. Inverse of a square matrix A means if I multiply A inverse with A from right or left, in both the cases, I will get an identity matrix. So, if A is a 2 by 2 square matrix, and then if I multiply its inverse with A from left or from right, I should get the identity matrix. So how to find inverse? We have several methods to calculate inverse of a square matrix that we will study. Next point is, the inverse of a matrix exists only when determinant of A is not equal to 0. So the determinant of A should not be equal to 0. So our matrix A must be non-singular in order to have inverse. So a matrix, a square matrix, is invertible only if the determinant A is equal to 0, is not equal to 0. So first, to find inverse, we should check whether the determinant of the matrix is non-zero or not. If it is non-zero, then the matrix will be invertible, and if it is zero, then the calculation of inverse will not be possible, as we will see in the formula for finding inverse. Next, the inverse of a matrix, if it exists, will always be unique. So we will have only one inverse for a given square matrix. And these are the three properties related with inverse. Inverse of a inverse is again the original matrix, and this property is like transpose of the matrices. So if I calculate inverse of a product of two matrices A and B, then it will be equal to the product of B inverse and A inverse. Further, if I calculate inverse of A transpose, that will be equal to the transpose of A inverse. So we can keep these properties in our mind for use, and you can take any square matrix to verify these properties. You can take any square matrix A, any square matrix B, to verify these identities. Now, to find inverse of a square matrix, as I discussed earlier, we use adjoint of a square matrix. So if we divide the adjoint of the given square matrix by its determinant A, then we will get the inverse of A. So I explain how to calculate inverse of a given matrix by using this formula, by calculation of adjoint and determinant. So for that, I am considering this square matrix A. So we note down this square matrix. So this square matrix A is a 3 by 3 matrix, and its entries are 3 minus 3, 4, 2 minus 3, 4, 0 minus 1, 1. Now to find inverse, first we need to find adjoint of this matrix A. So to calculate adjoint, we calculate cofactor matrix of A. Now the cofactor matrix of A is can be written in this form. So you can observe, I have calculated this cofactor matrix by the idea that cofactor is cofactor of any element. For example, cofactor of 3, 1, 1 position is obtained by removing the first row and first column and calculating the determinant for the remaining part of the matrix, that is minus 3, 4, minus 1, 1. In the second, for the second position element, minus 3, because this position is 1, 2 position, so the cofactor will have a negative sign. So you can see here minus sign, and for this minus 3, what I have done is that I have removed first row and second column. So I get 2, 4, 0, 1. So this is the minus, and when I multiply it with minus 1, it becomes cofactor. Because cofactor involves minus 1 to the power I plus j multiplication. So in this way, we can calculate cofactor matrix, and if we evaluate all the 2 by 2 determinants of this cofactor matrix, then we will have this cofactor matrix. So I have calculated cofactor matrix of the square matrix A. Now adjoint of A will be the transpose of cofactor matrix. So we need to remember this step every time. So first calculate cofactor matrix and then find the transpose of the cofactor matrix. That will give us the adjoint of A. So this is the adjoint of A. Further, I have calculated the determinant. The value of the determinant is 1. Now we can find inverse very easily. So you can observe the inverse will be adjoint A upon determinant A. Determinant A is 1, and I have written adjoint A. So A inverse is this matrix. So in the given square matrix A is this 3 by 3 matrix, then the inverse of A is this 3 by 3 matrix. And you can easily verify by multiplying A and A inverse that whether your answer is correct or not. By multiplying A and A inverse, we should get corresponding identity matrix. Means identity matrix of order 3, because the involved matrices are of order 3 by 3. So the resulting identity matrix will also be of order 3 by 3. So in this way, I have explained the idea of calculating inverse by that formula, which says that A inverse is equal to adjoint A upon determinant A. Next, we will discuss our main method, the Gauss-Jordan method, to find the inverse of a matrix. So in Gauss-Jordan method, we calculate the inverse of a given matrix by applying some row operations and column operations. So I develop some theory related with the Gauss-Jordan method. So to understand how to find inverse by Gauss-Jordan method or by elementary row operations, we need to understand what type of operations are there for matrices and we will also study how the operations lead us to the inverse of a matrix. So we have three types of E operation for a matrix. Number one is we can interchange two rows or two columns. So if I interchange ith row and jth row, that operation is denoted by rij. So if I change ith row and jth row, then I have this notation. I will write ij as a subscript, or I can write that ri interchange symbol rj. So if I interchange first row with second row, then I will write r1, 2. If I interchange second row with third row, so I will write r2, 3. Similarly, interchange of column. So this is the first type of operation on matrices. Next, we can multiply each element of a row or column by a constant, a non-zero constant k. So that is also known as operation. For example, if we have a three by three matrix, 2, 1, 3, 1, 0, 7, 3, 4, 1. So what do these operations mean? So interchanging R1 and R2, interchanging R1 and R2 will result in this matrix. So this is the first row and the second row. So by this operation, I mean I will interchange first and second row. So the resultant matrix will be this. Similarly, we can apply column operations. Next, the second operation, multiplication by a constant of any row, any column. So this operation is represented symbolically by rik. If I multiply ith row by the constant k, then I will write rik. This means that I am replacing ith row by kth multiple of ith row. So if I apply r1 replaced by 2r1 operation, then this means I am applying r1 2 operation. So I am multiplying first row with 2. So if I do this, so I will get a new matrix which will be equal to 4, 2, 6, 1, 0, 7, 3, 4, 1. So similar operations can be applied to columns also. So if I multiply I column with a constant k, then we have this symbol CIK, or CI replaced by KCI. Third property is the addition of k times the element of a row to the corresponding elements of another row or column. For example, for this matrix, if I apply this operation, if I replace R1 row by R1 plus 2R2, if I replace R1 row by R1 plus 2R2, that will give me a new matrix in this form. So for that, what I will do, I will replace first row by the first row plus double of the second row. So this operation means that I will replace the first row by the sum of the first row and double of the second row. So here I will have 2 plus 2 into 1. Here I will have 1 plus 2 into 0. And third position will be 3 plus 2 into 7. So you can observe I have applied this operation on the first row of the given matrix. Remaining row will remain as such, because this operation indicates change in first row only. So this is the result. Now we can calculate all the number. So the first position we will have 4, second position we will have 1, and on third position we will have 70. And second row and third row will remain as such if I apply R1 plus 2 R2 operation. So in brief, usually we simply write R1 plus 2 R2 to denote this operation. That will mean I am replacing R1 row by R1 plus 2 R2. So these three operations are known as elementary transformation, elementary operations. In brief, we will write T operations. Next, there is a point that if a matrix B is obtained from a matrix A by one or more E operations, then B is said to be equivalent to A. So if you, for example, here I have a matrix A, this is A matrix, and by applying an elementary operation I have obtained this matrix. So in terms of elementary transformations, E operations, we write that A is equivalent to B in terms of E operations. Next we want to understand the concept of elementary matrices. Elementary matrices will provide us explanation of the effect of E operations. If you want to understand the effect of row operations and column operations, that we can understand with the help of the elementary matrices. So first I define the elementary matrices. Elementary matrices or E matrices are defined as a matrix obtained by applying one E operation on the identity matrix I. So I is unit matrix, identity matrix. If I apply, for example, I have a 3 by 3 identity matrix, and if I apply any E operation on this matrix, the resulting matrix will be known as an elementary matrix. So it is a very simple definition. For example, if on that identity matrix, if I apply R23 or C23, means if I interchange second and third row, or if I interchange second and third column, then the resulting matrix will be same. So I will have an elementary matrix of this form. If I interchange second row and third row, or I interchange second column and third column in the identity matrix of order 3, then I will get this elementary matrix. And we have a special symbol for these elementary matrices. These elementary matrices means E23. So E23 means we have obtained this matrix by applying exchange, by applying interchange of second third row or interchange of second third column in an identity matrix. Similarly, we have notations for other E operations. So if we apply R25 or C25, means if I multiply second row by constant 5, if I multiply second column by constant 5 on the identity matrix I, then we will get this matrix. So this is an elementary matrix, because we have obtained this matrix by applying an E operation on the identity matrix. So if we apply any E operation on the identity matrix, the resulting matrix will be an elementary matrix, and to denote the elementary matrix in this case, we have this notation E2 5. So E2 5 will mean either we have multiplied second row with 5 or we have multiplied second column with 5. In both the cases, we will get the same matrix. Next, we have these types of operations R2, 3, 4. Means I am replacing second row R2 So R2, 3, 4 means I am replacing R2 by R2 plus 4R3. So this is the meaning of these symbols. So if we apply this E operation R2, 3, 4 on I, then we will get this matrix. And we denote this matrix by E2, 3, 4. So E2, 3, 4 means in a given matrix, in a given identity matrix, I have replaced second row. So this type of operation are different for row operation and column operation. So E2, 3, 4 means I have applied an E operation in which I have replaced second row by the second row plus 4 times the third. So for the operation rijk, we have this notation eijk. For this type of column operation, we will have a different elementary matrix. In both the above properties, we were getting same elementary matrix for row operations and column operations. Whereas in the third type of E operations, we will get different elementary matrices for row operations and column operations. So next we concentrate on the column operation. So if we apply C2, 3, 4, which means if I replace second column by the second column plus 4 times of the third column, then I will have this elementary matrix. And if you observe, this elementary matrix is the transpose of the matrix which we obtain while applying similar row operations R2, 3, 4. So we denote, in this case we denote the resulting elementary matrix by E-2, 3, 4, because it is the transpose of the E-2, 3, 4. So we have just these notations. So in this way, we have understood the meaning of elementary matrices corresponding to all the E operations. Now, we have a few theorems based on the effect of E operations on the matrices. So, the first theorem says that any E row operation on the product of two matrices is equivalent to the same E row operation on the prefactor. We can understand this by taking an example. If we have a matrix X which is equal to the product of A and B, then according to this theorem, the effect of, suppose I denote row operation by R symbol. So if I apply R row operation on the matrix X, then it will be, the resulting matrix will be equal to applying row operation on the prefactor only. So if will be equal to the application of row operation on the prefactor, that is A only. So application of row operation on matrix X will be equal to the application of row operation on A matrix only multiplied with B. So I have further given some example. So in this example, consider two matrices A and B, and we can multiply, we know how to multiply A and B. So if we multiply, minus 4 to 60. So now we can verify this operation, this theorem for this example. So in this example we have two matrices A and B, and we have calculated the product of A and B. Now if we apply R12 minus 2 operation, means if I replace first row by first row minus double of second row, then if I apply this operation both on A as well as on AB, and if in that case the resultant matrices are denoted by A bar and AB bar, then I will get these two matrices. And if I multiply A complement with B, so I will get a matrix equal to the AB complement. So this means that the effect of row operation, effect of this row operation R12 minus 2 on the product of A and B is equivalent to the product of applying product of A obtained after applying this raw operation into B. So these theorems will help us in understanding the fact that how elementary raw operations can give us the inverse of a square matrix. So for that purpose we are understanding these theorems. Second theorem is for column, which state that any e column operation on the product of two matrices is equivalent to the same e column operation on the post factor. So if we are applying a column operation C12 minus 2 for example, then if I calculate the product of A and B, and if I apply this type of column operation, then the result will be equal to A into a matrix obtained by applying this column operation on B matrix on post factor, that is on B, the second term in the multiplication of A and B. So this is the meaning of this theorem. Same example has been taken. If A is this 1 minus 1 0 2 and if B is minus 1 2 3 0, we can easily calculate the product of A and B. And then if we apply this operation C12 minus 1, that is C1 replaced by C1 minus C2 on both the matrices B and AB, so we will get these two matrices. So B lower complement, AB lower complement symbol have been used here. So these matrices are the matrices obtained after applying C1 minus C2 operation on B and AB. So now you can observe that if I multiply the original matrix A with the B complement matrix, then I will get a matrix equal to the complement of A, lower complement of A. So this verifies these theorems. In third theorem, we will discuss another theorem, that every E row operation on a matrix is equivalent to the pre-multiplication by the corresponding E matrix. So this theorem is different than about two theorems. This theorem provides us the way to understand the effect of E row operations in terms of E matrix. So we can compare the effect of row operations and the effect of pre-multiplication of E matrices. So every E row operation is equivalent to pre-multiplication by the corresponding elementary matrix. So I have mentioned effect of all the three types of E-row operations on a matrix A. So the effect of Rij, so if I interchange I throw and J throw in a given matrix A, so that is equal to the multiplication of the elementary matrix Eij with the given matrix A. And we have an example also for this property. So if we have a matrix A, which is a matrix of order 3 by 4. Now for this matrix, I have considered an identity matrix of order 3, because the number of rows, because I want to understand the effect of row operations, and the number of rows in this matrix is 3. So I am considering a 3 by 3 identity matrix. If you want to understand the effect of column operation on this matrix, then you should, because the number of column is 4, so we should consider a 4 by 4 square matrix to understand the effect of column operation in terms of elementary matrix. So here we want to understand the effect of row operation on A in terms of the elementary matrix. So for that we are considering identity matrix of order 3, because the number of rows in this matrix is 3. So if we apply R2-3 operation, means if I interchange second and third row on A, then we get this matrix. Suppose if I denote it by B, we get a new matrix B. Now if we apply the same operation R2-3 on the identity matrix to get the corresponding elementary matrix E2-3. So in the identity matrix I have interchanged second and third row, so we get E2-3. Now if you multiply E2-3 and the given matrix A, then you will observe that the result will be equal to the matrix B, which have been obtained after applying R2-3 row operation. Similar theorem is true for column operation, but for column operation the equivalence is with the post multiplication of corresponding E matrix. So in row operation case, the pre-multiplication of elementary matrix is equivalent to that row operation. In column operation case, the post multiplication of the corresponding elementary matrix is equivalent to that column operation. Further, if we apply a sequence of row operations on a given matrix A, then that combined effect of all those row operations can be understood in terms of multiplication of the corresponding elementary matrices. So we need to pre-multiply the corresponding matrices one by one. And for column operation, for a sequence of column operation, we need to post-multiply the corresponding elementary matrices. Further, there is a fact that the inverse of an elementary matrix is always an elementary matrix. You can verify this fact by considering any elementary matrix. Now, as per the above discussion which I have discussed, from that discussion we can understand that if we can understand that A is equal to IA. And now if I apply elementary row operations on A, If I apply elementary raw operations on A, then the resulting matrix will be equal to the application of the raw operations on I only. So A will remain undisturbed. So if I apply raw operations here on A, so that will be equivalent to applying raw operations on identity matrix on the right hand side, keeping A as unchanged. So A will remain as such. So if I apply a sequence of raw operations, and if by applying a sequence of raw operations only, if I can convert left hand side into an identity matrix, then suppose the identity matrix on the right hand side gets converted into a matrix B, then according to the above mentioned theorems, this I must be equal to B into A. And as per the definition of the inverse of a matrix, this B, in this case, this B will be equal to A inverse, because the multiplication of B with A is producing an identity matrix. So by applying a sequence of raw operations on A to convert A into an identity matrix, if we apply the same raw operations on the identity matrix, then the identity matrix will convert into the inverse of A. So this is the idea behind this Gauss-Jordan method of calculating inverse of a given square matrix, or the idea of calculating inverse by elementary raw operations. Similarly, if we want to apply column operations, if we want to calculate inverse by applying column operations, then in that case we will consider A equal to AI relation, and then we will apply column operations. So application of column operation on the left hand side matrix A will be equal to the application of raw operation on the post vector, that is identity matrix on the right. So in this case also, the if after applying column operation this A matrix converts into an identity matrix, then this identity matrix will convert into an inverse matrix after applying same column operations. So I have explained the logic and reasoning behind the Gauss-Jordan method. Now there are some points. As we know, inverse of a matrix will exist if and only if its determinant is non-zero. So if determinant is zero, then that case will be reflected, will be noticed in this method by the appearance of a zero raw or zero column. So if we are applying the sequence of raw operations to find inverse, and if at any stage we get a zero raw or zero column, then that means the inverse of the matrix will not exist and the determinant of that matrix is actually zero. So the matrix, given matrix, will not be invertible. Otherwise, this method will calculate the inverse of the given matrix. Further, one more point, the mixture of raw operations and column operation is not allowed. So that is why in many of the books you will find Gauss-Jordan method in this way, that you write the given matrix A and the identity matrix I side by side and start applying raw operations on A to convert A into an identity matrix, and apply the same raw operations on I to convert it into an inverse of the square matrix A. So in this manner, so this idea works because the application of raw operation in this case will give you inverse, and application of column operation in this case will give you inverse. So you can apply either only raw operations or column operation. If you apply mix of raw and column operation, then that will give you incorrect answer. That will not lead us to the value of the inverse. So that is also explicit with the idea which I have explained here by using the definitions of elementary matrices, E operations and elementary matrices. Now we apply this method to find inverse of a 2 by 2 square matrix. So we take a 2 by 2 matrix and we try to calculate and we apply this procedure on that 2 by 2 matrix to calculate inverse of that 2 by 2 matrix. So the given 2 by 2 matrix, suppose the given 2 by 2 matrix is this 1, 2, 2, minus 1, and we want to calculate its inverse by applying either raw operations or column operations. So as per our convenience, we can select any type of operation, raw operations or column operation. To explain, I consider raw operations. So to find inverse of A by Gauss-Jordan method, what we will do, we will write the given matrix A 1, 2, 2, minus 1 and the corresponding identity matrix, that is 1, 0, 0, 1, 2 by 2 order identity matrix side by side. So I have written A and I side by side. Now what will I do? I will apply raw operations on A matrix to convert it into an identity matrix, and I apply all those operations simultaneously to the identity matrix also. Then the identity matrix will convert into A inverse. So this is the idea behind this method. So our aim is to select raw operations which can convert this 2 by 2 square matrix into an identity matrix of this form. So we want to have 0 on off diagonal positions. Now for this, for getting identity matrix from the given square matrix, you should observe the principal diagonal. So this is the principal diagonal, 1 1 position, 2 2 position. Now in every column we will create 0 at the off diagonal position by using that principal diagonal entry. So by using this entry 1, I will try to create 0 below it and above it if I have some entry. Similarly, by using this principal diagonal entry minus 1, I will try to create 0 above this entry and below this entry if I have some number. So our aim will be to create 1 at the principal diagonal and 0s on the off diagonal. For that, what we will do? We will concentrate on one principal diagonal element and we will try to create 0 below and above that principal diagonal. We will decide our raw operations in that way so that we can have 0 below the principal diagonal element, above the principal diagonal element, and we can have 1 on the diagonal position. Then in that way, we will be able to convert the given square matrix into an identity matrix. So this is the idea. Now you see how I decide operations. So